reducing their water use by one-third, what crept into that story was the fact that 1.2 billion people on the planet don't have access to safe water. So the story is starting to get out there, but what we're finding out as the story gets out there is that the solutions to many of these communities and in some of these nations are so cheap compared to the size of the problem that it's you know, really is heartbreaking.
I'm going to ask a local question. I live 5 minutes from the Hudson, and I'm just curious if the fact that it's an estuary, the river that flows both ways, affects the cleanup. Does it make it more complicated?
Yeah.
Does the Mississippi River have an estuary down near New Orleans, but it has such length that it doesn't have the same complications? It's just huge. And, is it harder for us to clean up the Hudson?
The estuary from its mouth of the Atlantic Ocean to the Troy Dam. The Hudson River is an estuary. The bottom of the river is below sea level for that entire 154 miles, and the ocean sloshes in, and the fresh water comes down from the land and mountain, and the fresh and the salt combine. Sometimes the salt comes way north as far as Poughkeepsie when the season is dry out. And so we have a combination of fresh and salt water at the lower 154 miles, but it's tidal. We have a high tide, two high tides a day, and two low tides a day. So that means the river flows south for 6 hours, flows north for 6 hours, south and north. And that does complicate it, because in a one-way river, things are traveling south all the time instead of sloshing back and forth. The Hudson's got it better than Long Island Sound, because although the Hudson sloshes back and forth, it progressively moves towards the ocean. Along Long Island Sound's like a big bathtub. And everything just keeps on sloshing back and forth, and it doesn't drain anywhere near like the Hudson River drains. The Mississippi Delta is in part, an estuary, but it's nowhere near as long as the Hudson River is. But there are a lot of problems in contamination of that mud down there where the mud collects at the Delta, for certain. Every estuary is different. There's a book coming out around Earth Day called Oceans. It's published by Public Affairs Books. It's to accompany a movie by Disney called Oceans that's coming out on the same day. And I have an essay in there on estuaries, called Where Human and Nature Meet, in the book. And it talks about the nature of estuaries all over the world with the certain focus on the Hudson. Yeah, it's a semi-enclosed body of water where fresh water from the river meets ocean water from salt water from the ocean. And that's the dictionary definition.
John, in defense of advocacy.
Oh no! Don't get me wrong.
I know. Yeah. Just to give it its proper importance, it's people on the ground who have the common passion and are educated to a problem or problems. Who then are the force to educate others, to grow that commonality and affect public policy, and put pressure on advocacy.
Yeah.
However,
advocacy is always necessary, always will be necessary. It runs.
But then, given that the effectiveness of the advocacy is to move some of the people who are making public policy to deal with the corporations and with the advocates, and as you say, bringing them. But there's kind of an intrinsic contradiction given our capitalist system, which has to be dealt with, which is that the very corporations who are doing the polluting are in the business now, or perhaps for whatever reasons, it's got to be worth their while, of cleaning up. But part of that, like with General Electric and PCBs, has come from advocacy, from the pressure of the advocacy group. But that is really a force internally, almost schizophrenically, for corporations, which is very hard to overcome.
Well, I agree with you. But it's schizophrenic on both sides. It's schizophrenic for corporations and it's schizophrenic for advocates. Because if you're going to be an advocate for change, you have to be an advocate for all the kinds of changes that are necessary. And you have to be an advocate for political change, you have to be an advocate for social change, you're going to have to be an advocate for
technological
change as well. And that's difficult. So here's what we need to do. Here's what we need to do. We need to lobby. It's a whole different kind of activism. We need to lobby corporations as hard as we lobby government. We need to knock on the doors of corporations just like we knock on the doors of government. We need to demand meetings with corporate officers just like we demand meetings with congresspeople and senators. Doesn't mean the doors are going to open tomorrow, but they will open. And we have to lobby them to be corporate citizens. We have to lobby them to explain, since they control the marketplace, how the marketplace can be a force for good. And we have to lobby them to invest in that force for good. And, you know, we've already learned that lobbying government alone is not going to help us achieve our goals, because look what happened with the Clean Water Act, and people are getting sick and people are dying. If we have the luxury of time to focus on, you know, complete conversion and transformation first, and then get to the other stuff, it would be one thing. The challenge that we have to face, and I'm an advocate at heart, I always will be, the challenge we have to face is with 4 children in mid-dying, and with 19.5 million Americans a year getting sick, with